So I'm interested to see how the last few weeks are going. So normally you kind of could keep the kids up because you're reviewing and teach till the last day. I'm afraid that they might not be invested in if they have.
Okay, guys.
With the Conservation Commission meeting started for Wednesday, May 10th, 2017. We are being recorded, and if you are recording, please let us know. And if you could silence your cell phones, that would be appreciated. We're going to start off first with the public meeting, public comment for items not being heard today.
I was here a couple of weeks ago talking about the illegal driving that's going on out at Smith's Point, and I encouraged at that time everyone here to go out and have a look for themselves. And it was suggested that perhaps it might be a nice group outing when the weather got better. The weather's better now, and unfortunately what's going on at Smith's Point has only gotten worse. I don't know how familiar you guys are with the beach driving rules and regulations. If you haven't gotten your beach sticker, you might not have one of these. Basically, and I'll give you a couple of them, on item number 4, pretty much all of those do not do's are being done out there. You can also look on the, actually if people don't understand the verbiage, there's a nice picture here which shows where you can and cannot drive. On the back of the map also, it shows areas at Smith's Point where you can drive at certain times of the year and when you can, where you cannot. The little red dot things are where you cannot at any time of the year, and it's being driven on right now. There are areas that birds, piping plovers, oyster catchers, and the like would like very much to be nesting right now. Some of them, the fences have been knocked down by people wanting to access the entire area out there. Some areas, to my looking at, could use some fencing, but it's very obvious that no one is paying attention. The drivers out there are not paying attention to any of the rules and regulations that exist. I think for you guys to understand the enormity of it, you really need to go out there. There's a tremendous amount of natural erosion that's going on, but with people driving over the dunes and over the foot of the dunes, there's going to be even more erosion. So I would heartily encourage you guys to maybe set some kind of a date to meet out there and look at it as a group. I'm sure Jeff is familiar with the area and can be your guide, but it's pretty appalling what's happening out there. If anybody has any questions, I'm happy to blab on. Thank you.
Jeff, who's supposed to patrol this time here out there?
Our staff does Audubon and Conservation, which have some property out there too. These have to start to limit it. I know Audubon came back yesterday with ED and said that there were new areas that have been opened up, so it's definitely a kind of an ongoing issue out there. It probably would be, I tend to agree with Edie that it's hard to explain. It's easier to say. Because it's, pictures really don't explain it very well. But
well, what are we being asked to do?
Go see the problem, and then, I guess, come up with a way to, through your regulations, try to prevent it or rectify it or bring it back.
Well, worth taking a look at.
Or if you guys want to designate someone to go out to do it, I could take someone out there on their schedule.
I guess short of having a police presence out there, I mean, how does one actually stop people from doing it?
That's
a little bit of both.
Is there no signage out there right now?
No, there's a little bit, but it's tough work. There's not people that are constantly there, because it's short of Jersey barriers get torn down before.
So what about putting a camera out there to get license plates?
Steve Bender. The meeting before last, two of the members asked me questions. One was Mr. LaFleur and one was Mr. Steinau. And of course, time was short, so I didn't have time to answer them, or I didn't have them. Anyway, I thought about these, and I will. Mr. LaFleur asked me a simple question. He said, as far as the boat basin goes, Are the vessels responsible? Do they have some responsibility? And indeed, they do have some responsibility. But the major responsibility is with the boat basin, and I don't know if I'm repeating myself, but they are operating on the aegis of a Chapter 91 Mass DEP license, and it says standard waterways license conditions. And condition eight is, this waterways license is granted upon the express condition that the use of the structures, this waterways license is granted subject to all applicable federal, state, county, and municipal laws, ordinances, and regulations, including but not limited to a valid final order of conditions, etc. So the boat basin is responsible for the enforcement of the town bylaws, the state bylaws, so forth, and the federal laws, which prohibit the dumping. Then Mr. Steinauer asked me a simple question. He said, what should we do? And primarily, in my way of thinking, what you should do is become much more proactive in protecting the Nantucket waters. And what do I mean by that? I gave you all copies of this a number of meetings ago. It was a small copy, and it's the Nantucket Wastewater Management Plan update. And this update plan is, as far as I'm concerned, quite primitive. It doesn't address the problem. And it says, what is causing the pollution of Nantucket Harbor? And number one is the effluent from the septic systems, in the watershed. So, my second answer to Mr. Steinauer is that now that the Mattigat sewer is temporarily halted because of vote at town meeting, we should now look into the effect of the product from the composter compared to the septic system outflow. In other words, the sludge from the power plant, from the sewage plant, is being brought to the composter. The output of the composter, which when that system was designed, the engineer said that product always must be in a lined landfill cell, and I think it's 20 years gone by, it has never been in a lined landfill cell. So what effect does the leaching of this very high nitrate material into Long Pond and into Mattigat Harbor have in comparison with the leaching from the septic systems? That should be looked into. Number three, the second on this wastewater management plan, it says fertilizer. And that is really kind of wimpy, because it really should say agricultural chemicals, not just fertilizer. There are pesticides being used, and there are herbicides being used. And as a little aside, I was talking to Roberto, the health officer, last week, and I said, Roberto, you know, I was addressing the same fertilizer business. I said, in the process of building this bike path behind the Constant Spring, I said, I watched them. I said, I think they poured hundreds of pounds of glyphosate on the surrounding areas, much of which went directly into the harbor. And Roberto said, no, thousands of pounds. Okay, what do we know about the decomposition of the glyphosate is the main chemical in Roundup. What do we know about its decomposition? Its decomposition products, what does it do in salt water? What effect does it have on I mean, it's just ignored. They just use it. Okay. That was number three, fertilizer. This is fast and furious. Number four, stormwater. Now, stormwater, I addressed through the Chapter 91 amnesty license for the First Winthrop Corporation, where the state demanded that they clean those catch bases, 14 of them in the parking lot, and put oil-absorbing pillows in and so forth, but they never did it. They were asked to do it in 2009, and I brought it up to you people, and you immediately pounced on it, and they have done it. I was under the impression that this was a wake-up call for you guys, because many, many more storm drains that the town controls are in as atrocious condition or worse than those all around the harbor. Okay? So that has to be addressed. And in this wastewater management plan, the boats are not even mentioned. The boats are unequivocally a large source of pollution, a significant source of pollution. Okay, that's the answer to the two questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve.
Thank you.
We have a plan at some point to get the powers that be together.
Yes.
Harbor master, selectman.
Yes.
Yep.
That is in the works. It's scheduled.
Exactly. Comments? Okay. Let's move on to the public hearing, notice of intent. We have a couple continuances. We have Nantucket Island Land Bank, 17 Commercial Wharf, and unnumbered lots on New Whale Lane, New Whale Street. It's continued till June 7th. And Nantucket Community Sailing is to Bathing Beach Road is continued till May 24th. So we are going to begin with Vandenborn, 135 Well Winnet Road.
For the applicant, Art Casparo at Operee, we're before you tonight for the second public hearing on this application. Which is for residential redevelopment at 135 Walwinet Road. We have submitted revised plans and a narrative to address some of the questions and comments from the first hearing and the technical consultant. The plan in front of you, the two plans, one is a revised site plan and then the other is a revised architectural footprint. I'd like to briefly run through some of the changes that we've made and then try to address any questions that you may have. First, one of the bit of the discussion had centered around the septic system, the mound that was proposed in order to elevate that, which was going to result in fill within the mapped Barry Beach and land subject to coastal storm flowage. The owners have agreed to revise that design to a tight tank based upon the input from the commission and the
questions. We investigated that. So shown on the plan is a subsurface holding tank, which essentially eliminates the requests for waivers for fill throughout the site. So fill related to the barrier beach, the dune, and the land subject coastal flowage are no longer requested. And there'll be no on-site disposal. All of the waste will be hauled, pumped and hauled to Surfside. The other changes that we've made Luke Thornwell is here with us, who's done the house design, and he's worked quite diligently to reduce the footprint of the house into sort of a tighter, if you will, area, and such that we don't project over virgin ground in the area as much. And we've also included a structural footprint analysis, as you had requested, on the plan. And to sort of go over what's in front of you, what I show in red is the existing structural footprint on the ground. And then the area which is in the light gray crosshatch within the red perimeter is what is dwelling footprint. And the other areas within the red outline are currently porches, decks, and steps. And then the heavy black line is the proposed dwelling, porches, decks, and steps. And as you can see, we are moving the house in an easterly direction, further away from the vegetated well and resource area, and not, and keeping our stairs such that we have to have additional stairs because we're raising the height of the building to conform to the flood zone. And we're keeping the stairs within the what is currently structural footprint. We're also reducing the structural area that covers ground on that west side, the area between the red and the black lines. And then on the other side, we are proposing some expansion of the structure, much of which is, if it's not clear, it's over what is currently existing deck. And I know many of you were on the site visit, which probably helped, so that you can maybe visualize, what we're doing is really converting deck area to be part of the house. There is no expansion of bedrooms proposed as part of this. So it's really, it's a four-bedroom house right now, or it'll be a four-bedroom house at after construction. So we're not really increasing occupancy or use of the structure. We have also proposed, as you may recall from the initial hearing, to remove these boardwalks, which are all at grade and doing considerable damage to the vegetation. And then we would replace that with a single elevated boardwalk. I've included the square footage in the calculation. There's currently about 865 square feet of those boardwalks that are at grade. At the end of the day, there'll be no boardwalks at grade. And then I have included in the structural area, included in the calculations this time, just the 405 square feet of this elevated walkway, though that would be a fiber-grade walkway. And I would ask that some consideration be given, in that, while it's in the calculation, and we still are an overall decrease with that, it's a bit different, I think, of a structural element, given both the elevated nature and the fibergrate porous, which allows that light transmission. And we would expect to have and have seen on other elevated walkways of this type that there is substantial vegetative growth below them. We also clarified that the structure would be supported on piles. Whether they were helical or solid driven will be determined for structural engineering. But again, that gets back to the ability of both sand and floodwaters to migrate below the structure. We've changed the skirt boarding on the house to provide, I think it was at least a 33% opening instead of those tight gaps. All going to try to address the questions and comments that, like I say, we had heard at the first hearing. So I believe that this proposal is, much more in line with your performance standards, especially with the change in the septic system. The waivers that we still are looking for have to do with the structure within the 25 and 50-foot buffer zone, though we believe that it does qualify and meet the requirements for the waivers on the basis of a long-term net benefit by moving further away, decreasing the structural area, elevating the elevating the boardwalk. And the other, like I say, we included the color footprint to try to help you, I think, be able to see existing versus proposed elements, and they're all labeled in a key. And like I say, Luke is also here should you have additional questions about that. The silt fence would go around the house, and we're also, as originally proposed, removing an existing parking area. And then we have a slight expansion of this parking area, just enough to get a single zoning compliant spot on the property. And with that, we would be happy to address any additional questions, concerns that you might have with the application.
The parking area, don't have the septic field. Can you just keep the original one in the corner?
Well, that's not 9 by 20 either, so that would also have to then get expanded, and it's much further from the house, the carrying of the groceries and all those sort of things. So between the two parking areas, I mean, this one, functions even the way that it is. The only reason that we're asking for this, it's about a 6-foot expansion, is simply to be able to satisfy zoning with respect to an on-site spot.
Mark, have you read the Laurentine inspection report?
We have, yes, and we've tried to address those point by point in my response letter. The one, I guess, that I think would be somewhat, that I felt like I addressed them all, the building height and I think impacts on wetland scenic views. Again, the building height that we're coming up with is to meet the flood zone. And while there is additional work and massing being done to the house, from our perspective, given the clustering of houses that exist there, I fail to see how it really, and I, would welcome feedback or questions, but I don't see an adverse impact on that particular protected interest. The rest of them, I believe we've addressed. Perhaps there's a difference of opinion with respect to the structural areas, though I would very much hold, as I said, that the removal of all of these boardwalks that are resting on the ground and elevating them is, and is more than what we're doing here justifies the modest increase in the size of the footprint. Again, all moving towards the road, towards where there are all these other houses and away from the wetland.
Would you dispute his figures on but the existing footprint is 1,533 square foot, and you're asking for a proposed footprint of 2,615?
I believe that was prior to our changes, and so I've included on the plan, on the bottom, a pre- and post-analysis of the footprints, and I think that his numbers were our original application, also based on looking at sort of overall, and I've broken that down further so that you could in fact see. I have an extra copy of the hard plan if that would be helpful to you.
It might be, because I can't
it's
find it
right here. So this is the same one that's before you, and on the bottom of that sheet, it's the same one. You guys want an extra? You can see that we the current dwelling footprint is 910 square feet, and we are proposing 1562 of a dwelling footprint. So that's where we acknowledge that there is, an increase there of about 650 square feet. However, what we're doing is to reduce the existing decks and porches. So in other words, we see this as an infill project, and you can see that you had 1,316 square feet of decks and porches, and that relates directly to the red outline on the plan, on the site plan. So the 910 is the area that's crosshatched within the red area, so there's your dwelling, and then the 1,316 is the area between the crosshatch and the outer perimeter of the red line. So we're reducing our exterior decks and porches from 1,316 to the 888, which I felt that I would see that if we were to be, direct comparison there, you could look at the dwelling alone, or we've also included the boardwalks, but I kept them separate. And by getting rid of the additional 865 square feet of boardwalks at grade, the total pre-construction footprint on the ground that exists is just over 3,000 square feet. And at the end of this project, the overall footprint is going to be down to 2,853, with 405 of those actually a fiber-grade, elevated walkway. So that's where we see the, a pretty clear net improvement.
I understand the math, but the bottom line is that you're expanding the footprint in a very sensitive area and making it and increasing the mass, and that disturbs me. thank you for explaining it in such detail.
I've always sort of had a problem with this boardwalk factoring into it, because I think this site would have to come into compliance with regards to boardwalks anyway. And a couple of things on this: the next door neighbors are going to be probably forced into some situation where they're going to have to get to the beach too. So although the boardwalks are leaving this site, they're going to be two more likely to put in the next door properties. So I'd like to just sort of take that. I've sort of taken that out of my mind when I'm thinking about this whole thing. I appreciate the septic system going to tight tank. I think that was a problem we all had. But I'm sort of like to look at this project, at least personally, as just the house and the size and the height.
Expanding the house footprint within the 25. The boardwalks, to me, looked like they'd been in disarray for quite some time.
No, the boardwalks are if I may, are used, and what had happened was, and on a seasonal basis, when this area floods, they float and get moved around, and have to get moved back. So again, we would see that as another benefit, if you will, that an elevated walkway, that's not going to happen. We do feel that, if I may, in response, that it's fair to tie those together, because otherwise, perhaps that boardwalk's not going to change or come into compliance and is going to remain on the ground if we didn't do any expansion of the house at all. So we feel that we're doing this project all wrapped together. The elevated walkway in of itself is a fairly significant investment and project to do that, and so in terms of the neighbors, I'm not really sure.
Yeah, I know.
What to
just
say there?
Yeah,
I mean,
just a thought. I'm just
registered
thinking,
land.
I'm just thinking. I know it's not part of this application. So
I think it's worth agreeing with Art that existing boardwalk is one of the worst things you can have, especially part of it is in the wetland itself. And
can see back in some of the photos, but I'm just wondering if those were permitted at some point or if they just were laid down after.
There isn't files that I've been able to find. Likewise, though, on you know, historic photos that I've looked at, it's very difficult to tell whether or not there is a boardwalk or not. There are clearly paths, you know, in the 71 and even back to the 30s. There's a very, very clear path that I suspect had a boardwalk. It certainly looks quite aged. And, you know, I went through some of the NHA archives to try to see what I could find, and I couldn't find anything directly related to this particular property, though I did find similar photos of cottages and similar boardwalks that existed that I believe are probably, you know, was sort of the same type in this area, and that it very likely, I believe that it predates 1971, though it's difficult to prove that.
Well, with respect to Commissioner Steinhauer, I look at them as being separate issues. And my understanding is that all this expansion of the building is going to take place within the 50 foot.
That's correct.
And we don't normally allow any structural change there, and I feel we will be setting a bad precedent if we approved it. And so I'm sorry.
If I may, to
and if, without interrupting one of those, also I do feel there's an element of trying to keep everything within scale there. And I take your point. But, you know, there are more and more and larger buildings there. And I think that's very unfortunate for the impact on the area as a whole, which is part also of our curriculum.
If I may, with respect to Commissioner Shampoo's comments on the structures alone and looking at that, I didn't add up, and maybe I should have separately on the plan, but I just quickly added up so that we could look at and have a discussion pre and post using those numbers, so it's not new information. It's just if I take the boardwalk out of the equation, pre and post, and simply add the dwelling footprint and the decks and steps, I have 2,226 square feet in a pre-construction condition and 2,448 square feet, so a 222 square foot increase is really what we're talking about on new ground, if you would, there. And again, we are taking a position, which now you have the information to weigh whether or not that, in our opinion, that 222 square foot increase is more than justified by getting rid of 865 square feet of boardwalk at grade. It's almost four times.
These raised houses are interesting because the concept of a deck as opposed to a house is kind of moot because the whole house is up off the ground. It's kind of strange. Yeah, I'm not crazy about the increase. I guess the height doesn't. I mean, the height, obviously, I understand the height. I understand the flood zone issues I'm dealing with right now. But I'm not too happy about the idea of the increase, you know, inside the 25-50 with the ground cover. That's my concern. I do appreciate the boardwalk. I do think it's great. It looks like the neighbors are you're still having that linked into the new one.
No,
you aren't. Well, you have sort of the other. You have the other ones.
Those will all go away.
It makes me think that
the neighbor's going to lose their parking.
They're
going to
lose
it. So they're going to have to deal with some stuff.
That's right. Yeah, I think my main concern, though, is the ground cover increase.
Can anybody talk
illegal
said, and I think I stated in the letter that we would provide a third open. So whether it's the lattice or a bigger gap, we're still thinking about horizontal boards with bigger gaps. With respect to construction methodology, that is why we clarified in our original application, we had been sort of leaving open whether we would do frost walls, which would then, of course, still require, you know, with flood openings, would still require excavations for footings. And to meet your concerns from the first hearing and the protected interest, we've changed that to a pile foundation. So there will be essentially no excavations required. If you look at the size of the house that's in the gray area, Luke and I have talked, it could possibly be moved out towards the road to get in here to then drive piles, or it could be lifted straight up if we do the helical piles, and you can get a skid steer underneath there, which has the attachment. And then basically, if you're going to do a solid pile, you need a clear vertical area above to drive the pile. If you're going to do a helical auger type, it's basically a 5-foot section, and then you attach on the next one, bolt it, and so you don't need as much vertical height. You can actually work under the structure. So, though, and that's going to somewhat be dependent upon structural engineering and bearing capacity, which would be done, you know, afterwards. But we feel that we could accommodate either or without going beyond the sill fence and limited work that we've shown on the plan, and that we wouldn't need excavation for that. I think the only excavation which would have to happen would be related to the installation of the tight tank. And that would have had to happen if we were originally putting a new septic tank plus a septic tank processor, and now it's just a single holding tank.
Is there a setback on the front of the lot?
Yes. I don't have the zoning setbacks on this particular plan. I want to say off the top of my head that it's 20 feet, but I could confirm that for you.
This is what?
I don't have it on this. I don't have zoning on the plan, but we're not seeking zoning relief.
Yeah, just a thought.
All of it, pretty much. Pretty much all of it.
Consideration for the
proof for any case claiming grandfathering is on the applicant. That burden of proof clearly hasn't been shown in terms of just the pre-existing use in terms of boardwalks. If you go to some of the aerials, granted maybe we can put them out, the boardwalk isn't there. So I don't think that they could say it's a pre-existing grandfathered use. I think it's actually a violation. And you could easily issue an enforcement order and they could come back and say, okay, well, the trail's there. Thus, we have to separately work on this graded walkway. I don't see any connection. As you read the regs, that there is a connection between removing boardwalk and getting 650 square feet of building in each area. That's never been done. Also, one thing as it gets back to the vegetated wetland, note they are in a small corner triangle. They're converting a porch in wetland, a porch, a deck, to an enclosed building in a wetland area, which, again, I don't think we're going to do that. That's it for that one.
If I might, I think you're entitled to take into consideration everything that's proposed to be done on the property, including elimination of the boardwalks as part of the mitigation for the project. I think everybody who's been out there has acknowledged that these boardwalks, although it may be hard to determine exactly when they arose, these are not new things. They've been out there for a long time. I think it's pretty obvious from looking at them. And I think the fact that we're eliminating those and putting in the new one that would be a much better solution, as everyone's been pointing out, does provide the necessary benefit and justification. And once again, what we're primarily dealing with here in terms of the increases, most of it relates to simply the difference between what's already land that's covered by a structure, whether it be part of the house itself or decks, and what we continue to be covered by part of the structure. Increase overall is very small. So I think that we have the justification. Obviously, it's up to you to determine whether the mitigation is adequate, but you do have the justification for it.
I'd also assume that given the fact that their property does run all the way to the beach, that it's almost sort of similar to a situation where we allow walkways across marshes. Question, even if it wasn't grandfathered, I would think it's a similar sort of situation.
Yeah, not this.
Well, no, the perpendicular ones, I agree.
Yeah.
I agree.
I mean, it is pretty clear on the performance standards that it brought them out for barrier beaches. No new septic systems or buildings shall be constructed on a barrier beach. Buildings which pre-exist these regulations may be maintained and repaired. Existing septic systems may be maintained, repaired, and upgraded to the best available technology. No expansion of septic system shall be permitted. And I know I've had problems with like structure versus building. This is pretty clear about not constructing or expanding buildings, which is different than a structure in our regs. So.
No, I think a deck is part of the building.
We're not expanding the septic.
That's right.
Right, the septic would be
an upgrade without an expansion.
But just the building
capacity.
I think we've got to look at it as the total footprint of the building right now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The footprint to the new footprint was the building. Mm-hmm. It's a different building.
222 square feet.
Right.
Like that's without the stairs.
No, that's with the stairs.
Mm-hmm. What was the 700?
That is the boardwalk.
So that would be taking the boardwalk out, right? If we were to just look at the structure. you know, our the case, and again, this is, I think, the for your consideration, that is that that does that that size of an increase is justified by the rest of the mitigation, which are structural elements impacting the resource area.
Right. Once again, though, you're saying the steps, but in your dwelling footprint size, you pre 910 and post 1562.
So that's just dwelling. That would be your interior space, because I knew that you wanted that from the last time to understand. So that was what Mr. Collier referenced in terms of the 600.
Gotcha.
So there is the increase there, but again, most of that occurs within existing. You know, there's a very large deck, you know, area that's already impacting the ground, and I think that it's only fair to interpret the regulations as the deck as part of the building.
This is an open deck on the front side, right?
That's correct.
It's a tough one. I think it really hobbles the performance standard a little bit going forward.
Right.
And would we allow even this small increase if there was nothing on the site? No, we wouldn't allow building in this area.
Yeah, it's just such a, you're next building, but man, that's a totally different animal.
Right.
Yeah, a covered.
Right now, the building's on piers, right? It's not on some foundation.
No, it's on like concrete block piers.
Right.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It isn't technically.
But it's low.
It's low,
yeah.
Right? So it's like right down.
Right.
The bottom. So the only sand, let's say, in that situation is under the front porch. Base up.
Join me before Board of Appeals with the Planning Board stating that decks and stairs are part of the building. I would greatly welcome it because under zoning there.
Well, they're not part of ground cover.
Which is considered the building.
But it's a different concept. So they certainly are part of the building, whether they're ground cover or not.
And the setbacks certainly apply.
In any event, if we're all finished, I think we would like to continue to the next meeting.
Okay. Let me see if anyone else has any other questions. Any other questions from the public on this one? Okay. So I'd like to continue for 2 weeks.
2 weeks, please.
Okay. So we will continue.
Thank you.
2 weeks.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Little Point Acquisition, LLC, 11 and 13 Hollow Lane.
You got a brother there, man?
No.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Commission, my name is, for the record, Lee Wisher from the Woods Hole Group. I'm here with Art Gasparo from Nantucket Engineering. I hope we have something that's very straightforward today. But one never knows. So what we're asking for is the project is located 11 and 13 Hollowell Lane. We're asking permission to repair two existing groins that are fully functional at this time. In 2007, we came before the Commission and asked to repair the seaward section of the groin because they were deteriorated. And in the ensuing years, the landward section of the groins are starting to deteriorate, and so we want to do maintenance on to replace deteriorated piles and the structure of the groin. all the repairs are going to be above mean high water. We initially filed with Natural Heritage with their sites, with their maps online, and their maps online did not show us in their jurisdiction. However, they have roughly told us they have some super secret maps, which are, and we do fall into there. So that's why we had a couple of continuances. We had originally in the notice said that we would adhere to the time of year restrictions, and indeed when they sent their letter back, that was their only restriction, was their time of year restrictions. So that's the way that one rolled. We proposed to access the site using Jetty's Beach. We would use a rubber-tired excavator and front-end loader, making one trip a day. No materials would be stored on site. The sand, we propose to dig out the piles. The sand would be reserved on site, and then once the piles were replaced, the sand would be replaced, and then beach regraded. Any of the materials that the damaged piles would be disposed of properly off site. And we anticipate the project to take no more than 3 weeks to complete our edge of that.
No, I think the only point I would make is that the plan does specify the elevations of the structural elements, and everything that's being proposed is an in-kind repair. So there's no proposed expansion, and it's really, as we see it, doing what should be done to maintain a structure so that it doesn't fall into disrepair.
Question for you guys. If you're accessing from Jetty's, are you going to be hitting a series of other groins that you're going to need to go down into the water line to get past?
Well, that's a very good question. In the summertime, typically those groins are above mean high water. Right now, they're right at the ends of them, right at mean high water. So it is possible for the one trip a day, we might have to go slightly below the mean high tide line, but we don't anticipate that's going to be the case in the summertime.
You're going to drive and do this in the summertime?
Well, in the fall, excuse me, after the
time of year
restriction. August 31st. So it would be in September time frame.
It would just be a transit. It would just be no work. It would drive around the bottom of the other groin.
It would be once
a
day.
Proper tide.
Are these driven?
Yes.
So you can just be able to do that with the
tracking. So yeah, the excavator with vibratory handle.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Cool. We envision the two machines that would work together. In other words, typically what they would do would be to put forks on the front of the bucket of the loader to carry the piles and the materials down there, and then the excavator just with two machines working together. And obviously, we can wait for the tide up on the beach here. We need to get back around.
So everything down, take what you need for the day, take it back, nothing gets stored.
No storage of materials on the beach, correct?
And no parking of vehicles overnight. You need everything to transit off at the end of the day.
How many trips do you anticipate needing to make back and forth to do this?
Well, once a day for about three days.
Tops, and I don't think you would need the machines for all that time. I mean, I'd be surprised if it was. I can't even imagine you would have them there for actually even. Work weeks, 10 days.
The letter from DEP, the questions on the applicant did not provide written permission. Was that all?
So that was all addressed. That was the original letter from Natural Heritage, and those were the points exactly that we did. So we continued.
Gotcha.
Instead of coming before you, provided a response letter. Got there.
So those responses were provided to the commission. So
yes,
we do have email correspondence from the trustee saying he gives me and the Woodsville Group permission to act on their behalf. This is similar to what we did in 2007 when we did the repair. The homeowner had paid for both repairs, and so that they were the beneficiaries of that.
And if I may,
sure.
If it's not clear, this parallel to the property line, second groin is 3-4 feet just over of the line, so that's the reason for, well, as a single applicant, the permission of both owners, which is making sure that everything is
properly. We had had that before we even filed the application, so we had clarified it.
Yeah, it's all that. Like,
so where are the photographs?
What's that?
Well, it asked for photographs, representative.
Yeah, we did provide those in the response.
Mm-hmm.
Basically,
but
just they want ground level. They just wanted some ground level photos of the beach.
So, how high will the groins be when they are replaced?
The same elevation that they are right now. Essentially, what are they?
So, if I may, we have a top elevation here of marked on the plan of 5.3, and the beach right next to it is 3.1, so just over 2 feet.
From the
beach grade to the top of the groin, and that obviously changes with the change in the beach.
Right.
And we've done that on both sides. I guess the other side at this point here is be slightly higher at, this groin is 5.7, so you're 4/10, 3 inches higher in elevation.
So would you provide the commission with the photographs as well, please?
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
We have.
They were
copied.
Sure.
Excellent. Thank you.
We provided them.
Right.
We didn't.
Yeah.
It's okay.
Other questions? Any questions from the public?
After August 30th?
Sorry?
After August 31st? Because of bird restrictions? So it would be after that time?
My concern was I've actually worked as a bird monitor in that area before, and if the birds, the piping plovers specifically, don't make it on their first round of nesting, don't make it on their second round of nesting, it gets pushed later and later into the season. So this work would be contingent on their not being flightless piping plovers in the area
absolutely.
At that time.
Sure.
Because
yeah.
They do utilize that whole Hollowell, below the Hollowell area.
No, absolutely. We would not propose working with them or any birds.
Okay. No more questions.
Jeff, we have everything we need for us?
Yes, we do.
You guys traded to us?
Yeah.
Move to close.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Hummock Pond Realty Trust, A6 Hummock Pond Road.
For the record, Don Bracken, Bracken Engineering, and Brian Madden, LEC. I'm sure that most of you probably recall this project from last fall. We have filed for an amendment to previously issued order of conditions. Pretty much the plan that we have in front of you now. We originally submitted the same plan that we filed for the amendment. Since the Laurentide report, we did add some additional notes and make some, basically some additional notes to answer some of the questions that were brought up. If you recall, the structure is placed outside of the 50-foot buffer from the bordering vegetated wetland. The project has begun under the order of conditions that they currently have, which, by the way, expires May 18th, which is the reason we submitted the new notice of intent. During that, the construction that has taken place is some of the clearing, the silt fence has been installed, and also, if you recall, we're proposing a drywall system for the roof runoff and for the foundation drain for the proposed crawl space foundation. Two drywalls were actually installed according to the plan. We've gone out and re-inspected them a few times since they've been installed. They did go in as we anticipated, some perched water table near the surface or within a few feet. And then when we got through the impervious soil, we hit dry, clean sand where we placed the perforated portion of the pipe. It was backfilled with the natural material so that we could maintain that perch condition. The only water that will be going into it will be if there's any water around the crawl space foundation into that perimeter drain into the drywall. And also, we added the roof runoff into the drywall as well. We don't anticipate digging into the groundwater when the crawl space goes in. There will be the excavation will have 6 inches of stone, and then the crawl space will be placed on top of that. And in that 6 inches of stone will be a 4-inch pipe that goes into that drywall system. During the excavation for the drywells, as I said, it stayed pretty dry, especially when we hit the sand. There was some perch water table, not enough that we think will require any dewatering. Also, because the drywalls are already installed, the plan is as the contractor puts the stone in and the pipe in, we'll be working backwards from those drywalls. So the excavation will be draining through the stone as they dig it into the drywalls. So no dewatering is proposed. Also, as part of the plan, some of the existing disturbed area within the 25-foot buffer will be replanted. One of Laurentide's comments was what kind of plantings were going to be installed. We did add to the note to the plan, and Brian Madden gave us that information to add and also put it into a supplemental letter. It consists of bayberry, high bush, blueberry, and arrowwood shrubs. We are asking for a waiver of the disturbed area between the 25-foot buffer and the 50-foot buffer. As proposed, this plan, as I mentioned before, mimics the original approved plan where the silt fence is now and where it's currently cleared. As you can see, there's very little area to deal with considering the driveway location and having some yard area around where the foundation is going to go. The other element we added to the plan that was realized when they started the project was the electric connection, where it was going to come from. So there is a pole to the north of the site that has a connection that they can tie into. We added an underground electric line going to the house. The installation and the trenching will be within the 3-foot grass strip that's already there. So there won't be any clearing to install that electric line into the existing shrub. That will be re-loamed and reseeded when that's completed.
problems with people clearing in the buffer zone and right into wetlands, is that going to be marked so that the lawnmowers or whoever are continuing to clear?
We didn't propose that, but if that's something that you're currently requiring, then I'm sure they would be open to it.
Well, you certainly have shoehorned it in there, let's put it that way.
Right.
So I can see why that could be a concern going forward.
Mm-hmm. Feel like maybe fence post or posting real fence or something like that?
Stones. We've had.
You can certainly condition to require some sort of permanent marker in place there.
Mm-hmm.
But they can choose whether they post their own fence, stones, mm-hmm. gargoyles, whatever they want to put. Mark gargoyles.
Right.
Yeah. Well, as long as it's marked.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Some permanent marker of their choice.
Mm-hmm.
The owner, Mr. Jack, was just there. I don't know if you want to.
Yeah, I agree. Jim Jackless. It's pretty much overgrown anyhow, so you know that the pump's expanding into it, but we put some natural blocks periodically to space it out. That's good.
Great.
You're on town lines.
Correct,
right?
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
Better deal.
Yeah. That's where we got all the soil information. Originally, so pretty confident where that groundwater elevation was. So.
Any questions? Questions from the public?
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I'm Mark Collier, Nantucket Land Council. In regards to the disturbance within greater than 50% of the, was it the 50 or 25?
Yeah.
It seems that you're proceeding, that you're fine with this. I think if you could make it a specific finding that says this was previously permitted before that came into existence, so that there's nothing in the future, basically, that says for other applicants, although not necessarily precedent setting, but if somebody just proposed a house to you, I would be surprised if you did allow them to do what they're proposing. Did the old application have lawn area all the way up to the front? It did have that proposed lawn area.
Right. So it's very similar to my Permian
Island. And then I just wouldn't, right now, what they don't have anything else. It's just lawn
right
around the house. So I sort of would encourage them to figure out exactly what they want for the landscaping, because they're going to have to come back to it if they put in one time change, which seems silly for them. I was sort of surprised that it just said lawn and then a house. But just so you know.
Other questions? Jeff, we have everything we need to close on this one?
Yes.
Ready to close?
Ready to close.
Second.
All those in favor? Any opposed? Nantucket Island Land Bank, 0 Bolton Street.
What?
Brian Madden from LEC Environmental, representing the Land Bank. Proposed restoration work. At the last meeting, we had some discussions about confirming the cedars that were planted, and I did speak with Rachel this afternoon, and she did confirm that they are, in fact, the native varieties. And what has been installed is kind of a mix between there's some 4 to 6 footers, and there's some 6 to 10 footers mixed in. Did receive this afternoon the Natural Heritage Letter stating that no adverse effects. resource area habitat. As noted in the notice of intent, this is part of a larger restoration project. The Natural Heritage just did note that, and we'll make a cumulative final decision once that other notice of intent comes in. But they said they have everything for an order of conditions to be issued for this one.
Questions? Questions from the public? Okay. Jeff, are we all set with this one? Got everything we need to close?
Yes. We were really just waiting for last night for the
Jones Family Partnership, 75 Pocomo Road.
All right. Jeff Blackwell for the applicant. The Jones family is selling this property, and they want to be able to brush cut up to the top of the bank and to permit a set of beach stairs. There's no structure. Well, there's no ability to build a structure within the buffer zone because of the flag-shaped nature of the lot. So the this application is for brush cutting within the buffer zone and then working on the face of the coastal bank to build a set of wooden beach stairs, which are just a sort of a generic set of beach stairs, no landing, just straight shot down into the bank as a water dependent use.
So they've been using the other stairs until now?
Well, the other property where a home is situated is also in the extended Jones family, and that's a separate lot. So this vacant lot would be sold separately.
Gotcha.
And there is a set of beach stairs, which I included pictures of those stairs.
Are we going to brush cut all of this up to the front?
They want to just have a trail cut up to here.
And then widen the trail?
Widen this out in here, into the buffer zone, and then the stairs. Future structure will be situated back here.
So, 75.
The stairs are 4 feet wide by 26 feet long.
Yeah, that's the cleared area. Outside of beyond the 25.
Yeah, the clearing within the 25 foot setback to the bank is 300 square feet, and that's only that wide to provide workmen access to build the stairs, and then that can come back in.
Oh, so that they don't want to necessarily leave that, I mean.
The 12-foot width.
So they're just drilling on their lot more than 50% of the 25-50-foot buffer. It looks like it. It looks like we've got all of them.
No, these areas here are just within the 25.
Okay, but then that 25 is 25, so 50 is probably about right here. But it looks like we've got almost everything on this lot.
That's so.
percent restriction?
Honey is only on vegetated land. I can check that for stuff. We were drawing, and I'm like, oh, but it's not focused on this.
But are we going to clear up to there and then have lawn and irrigation going right up to the 25?
There's no proposal. You're going to find a buyer's application to come back. And
so my feeling is, why brush cut that whole area when the buyer can come back with their own landscape plan to do that? I'd rather just see brush cutting to access the stairs.
Well, I assume that you would increase the venue of the property by having the stairs in.
Right.
I think you're quite within your rights to come before.
Right. Yeah.
It's not
right,
a
the stairs,
project.
Yeah.
Right.
But either the cutting or the stairs. I can inquire. We have to. We're still waiting for Natural Heritage response, so we have another meeting before us. And I can inquire the owner, and if he's willing to dial back, then I'm happy to bring that back to you.
What's the erosion rate at this location?
The erosion rate is quite small in this area. I can check that for you. I didn't look at the CZM mapping, but I can check that for you as well.
No, and we're also waiting for Natural Heritage.
Money to not have to clear more, so they're just going to sell it anyway.
Okay, I'll check.
Other questions? Questions from the public?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I caught, I need to check the Land Council. It has been the Land Council's opinion ever since we notified the owner in 2006 that this lot has merged with the other lot next to it. They were in under the same ownership when the parents were alive. This is probably most likely going to be an ongoing issue. It is not in your purview. I would respect to just ask that you put a condition that states if it is determined that this lot is found to be merged with the abutting lot, that only one set of the stairs shall exist for the two lots. Because then, if we are correct in our contention, and that isn't been there, they're going to have two sets of stairs for just one lot.
Do you know about this merge?
Yeah.
So we'd have 2 weeks to sort it out.
Sort it out. Okay. That's a good point, though.
I don't think we're going to solve the
dispute.
I think we're going to look into the how to phrase a condition like that.
Yeah.
Correct.
No, it seems like a sensible proportion.
The doctrine of merger, when it comes to a situation like this, will most likely have to be decided by town zoning official and or the attorney.
I think it would be up to a succeeding condition. And if there's already set of things where it's not allowed, we would probably be very unlikely to allow another
right
there. And if set, I think the succeeding condition would be the same, but if the succeeding condition
right
could be constrained, I thought that was one of our things we could constrain future conditions.
No, but I think there's a way to rate that condition that doesn't need
an advisory.
Right. Some time to put some pen to paper.
A little history for the next
figure.
Yeah.
Sort that out of motion.
Okay. So we're going to continue. 2 weeks.
Okay. Thank you.
Now, real quickly, Mr. Chairman, we want to take them down. The next two filings, the town of Nantucket filing and the Alan A. Shook filing.
Yeah.
That project is a joint project.
Right.
But it's, so they are using the same plans, but they're for a separate above. types, and did them as separate notices.
Yeah.
But I think what I'm saying is if you guys want to take those at the same time, you'd be taking the same.
Right, action. Well, there wasn't anything for shook because they were the same.
Yes. It's the same.
Same. Okay, so the town of Nantucket, Satchikapon, and Smiling Shook, 45 Whitman Road.
Correct. Nope. You guys are like three lots away.
Today. We're focusing on about 5,700 square feet of area along the coastal bank on both properties, and we're proposing invasive plant removal, bank stabilization, and native plant restoration. And this is all in an effort to provide more meaningful habitat for wildlife and improve stormwater function on the properties. So currently, the vegetation existing on the bank is primarily invasive, non-native, and aggressive in nature. There's some really aggressive species found here. We have Asiatic bittersweet, autumn olive, border privet, shrub honeysuckle, and most notable is the bamboo. It's covering, as you can see in a hatch on both of our plans, it's covering almost half of the project area. And bamboo, as you likely know, has the ability to form dense thickets that outcompete native vegetation. So we're proposing to remove all the non-native species. We would do our, you know, we're very careful in saving any native species, even if it's just a little sprig of something, barely holding on with the invasive thicket that's out there now. And we propose to remove all the non-native vegetation mechanically, where we had good access, probably closer to the road, and then by hand, where there wasn't good access, and that is, the access is quite difficult. So a lot of this work we're proposing would be hand removal just because of the access issues. There's about two trees, one non-native tree and one cedar tree at least. It's hard to really see what's going on there with all the bamboo, but there's a non-native black Japanese pine and a cedar that are almost enveloped in the bittersweet. So we're proposing to do our very best to maintain those two trees. But not remove them, but we're not really sure what the condition is right now of the trees. So we might be asking to prune slightly just because there is likely dead vegetation there, but we'll be doing our best to preserve those two trees. So once the removal occurs, we would immediately stabilize the area by seeding the entire area with a native mix that's identified on our plan, and then using erosion control blanketing where necessary on the steeper slopes. And once the invasives are held at bay, we would be replanting with native plants identified on our restoration plan. And these native plants are really appropriate for these conditions. We're proposing a maritime shrub community. You can see on our plan arrowwood, beech plum, rose, bayberry, just to name some of the shrubs we're proposing. And along with that, we really want to get that herbaceous layer growing and thriving. The native grasses in particular do the heavy lifting for stabilization. They have root systems that really go down deep and hold and bind the soils. So we're seeding the area and then plugging with little blue stem beach grass and purple lovelock grass, just to name a few species. And that's really the important thing on a bank, as you know. I'm sure you've heard Seth talk about it, but really to get that grass layer established, we'll do the heavy lifting for erosion, to prevent erosion. In total, we're proposing 96 shrubs, and then with the seed and the plugs, it's really thousands of grasses and forbs that would be planted and growing on this bank. And as I mentioned initially, this is all in an effort to promote an improved habitat area for wildlife, and also to improve stormwater infiltration on the properties. So with that, we'd be happy to answer any questions.
What's the Abaca Daniel de Benedictus? Is she involved at all with this?
No.
So is that going to impinge on your desire to keep all the invasives at bay? I assume she has invasives on her side.
That's why we propose a 3-year program to just, you know, you get most of the work done initially, but we are going to have to keep on continuing to come back, and especially along those edges. We run into that on nearly all of our properties, but that edge condition is right where stuff starts to come in.
And she's expressed no interest?
We haven't spoken with her. Originally, Mr. Shook's idea to do the work on his property,
yeah.
And that's why we got the town property involved, because it's a pretty good community to do on
right.
That property as well. So
right.
It's going to take care of most of it. I think there might be a small amount.
It's
on
minimal.
The butter, but not nearly like it is.
It's on mainly on these two properties.
Is this a taller tree?
Proposing to treat with inject them with an herbicide to kill the bamboo, and then you don't have to dig everything out, but like treating it at the source. By hand meaning injecting. Right, definitely. Injecting.
Maybe the same for the honeysuckle. I mean, I'm listening to your little notation. Same thing.
Right.
No point. Yeah.
There's no porcelain berry down there, but
there will be.
I didn't see any.
It's further up the street now.
Right.
Today.
Let me give it some nice space.
I'm sure it's going to make its way there.
How do you plan on managing the area that looks like it's below the water line?
This water line here?
Yeah.
Well, the first water line is the 2005 water line. It's below. The current water line from last year is the blue line that's further out.
Yeah, and, well, obviously when I was out there just recently, the water line.
I was just out there today, and the water is a nice beach,
yeah,
so
the
vegetation that we're proposing to remove is far from the water line.
And you're proposing to do the work in the next month or so?
Correct.
I'm going to break my heart if you leave that Japanese
Unfortunately,
we don't.
They are both within natural coverage, so they don't care for them. But we thought it'd be smart in case there are any questions or any other information. But if that seems like it's the bill of the board, we can grab the deposit order for next time. And if unless Matt Shapiro which sends an earth shattering piece of information, we can try to get them started on a project like this.
I guess we'll continue for 2 weeks.
Yeah. After hearing just slow and then some of the things we're going to do. Emily, Daisy is there, but they so continue for 2 weeks?
Okay,
we'll
continue for 2 weeks.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Orders and conditions. Providence Associates LLC, 11 Village Way.
Good afternoon, Mark Ritz from Site Design, representing the applicants in Village Way. This is an oldie but a goodie. It's an old order of conditions that allowed for the removal of cesspit, which is about 10 feet from coastal bank. The coastal bank is well vegetated, a pretty stable area, there isn't any erosion. When we originally permitted this, we were putting the proposed septic system outside the 100-foot buffer. At the time, we had approval from the Board of Health to place it where we wanted to place it. Unfortunately, the applicant did not do the work. The order is still valid, but there has been a change in how the Board of Health interprets various regulations, and the area where the septic was going to go is within a couple of 50-foot well buffers on abutting properties. So the Board of Health told us that we applied for a waiver, they said no, and they outlined an area where they would like us to place the septic. Where they would like us to place the septic puts it outside of the 50-foot well buffers, which is a public health concern, but it puts it inside the 100-foot buffer to the coastal bank. It's outside the 50, but it's inside the 100. The septic system we're putting in is an IA system, so it'll provide the maximum treatment, and it's a good way further from the bank than the existing cesspit, which is providing the least possible treatment. So we are here to request the septic system outside the 50, inside the 100. We obviously need a waiver for this. We had a waiver previously for removing the cesspit, which is here. Our proposed septic is going here. That's the 50-foot buffer. The original location was here, and you can see all the pink well buffers. We really don't have another place on the site that's better suited from public health standpoint, so that's why we've cited it where the Board of Health wanted it cited.
I will say nothing about that. This is a project that I have spoken with Roberto and Artel at great length about and fought hard for a different location, but they convinced me that supporting public health and kind of compromising to the best location for both groups is where this kind of ended up. The original design was in a different spot, and the health department said, no way are you putting this in.
So
it's in like four well radiuses, and that did like not happen.
And they're all off-site wells that we can't move, we can't control. If they were ours, we would be able to play games with that, but unfortunately they're not.
Questions from the public? If you have recommendations.
I recommend you could close the issue.
Okay. Motion to close the issue.
So moved.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Passed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
first of all, confirm the wetland boundary and then also allow brush cutting of the lot down to 50 feet off of the wetland boundary.
I'm not even sure if it's a bordering or an isolated, because it's, you know, that area. There's little ditches here and there. I'm assuming it's bordering vegetated wetland. It's a shrub swamp. There's areas, patches of wet meadow, winterberry holly, sweet pepper bush, arrowwood, the usual suspects. There are trees on the site. Most of them are within the 50 feet of the wetland boundary, so they would not be affected by the brush cutting. The rest of the site is low shrubs, including bramble, rose, and they would just like to brush cut it. I think the property is probably coming up for sale, and they want to improve the viewing of it. And no soil disturbance is proposed, unless the mower is like I am and scalps every once in a while, and then we would proceed with a conservation seed mix, any kind of disturbance. I'm sure you all mow like I do, so.
You mow like that for Dan, you get fired.
My brush line, you know. My brush line. Shorten the rock.
Meadows don't require
mowing. Is that for you and?
Yes. Yep, it's been reviewed and the vegetative level is correct.
Yes, we'll put up a silt fence at 50 to demount the edge.
Questions? The recommendation?
The recommendation of a positive 2 and a negative 3.
Okay, would someone like to make that recommendation?
So moved.
Second? All those in favor? Any opposed?
Thank you very much.
Minor mods, Burke 37 Gardner Road.
All right, this is one that we have been waiting for a stamp plan for. As you can see by the design, our thunder. It's just for the extension of the already permitted two rows of core logs
to get
to tie into the open area.
For the applicant, Mark Gasparo. Stan Humphreys of LEC had originally filed this request for the minor modification, and his letter explains what was proposed, and then he had asked me if I would prepare this plan, and what I did was to try to highlight it for you, show it in red exactly what the subject of the minor modification is, which is as Jeff described. The original approval had stopped at the stairs, and there's an area between the stairs and the existing carp bulkhead, and it's about, I think, 48 linear feet, and it would just be two 20-inch coir logs, and then a 6-inch veneer of sand on top of those with some beach grass. So that was the plan to match the request.
Say that is a definition of minor modification.
So the difference, just so I'm clear, you're not adding a third log here.
Right.
And you're not going to cover the previously permitted section. You're only going to use the 6-inch sand cover here.
No, so not adding a third, not adding the third row, correct,
mm-hmm.
has been removed from his proposal. My understanding was that we would put 6 inches of sand just on top to try to get some plant some beach grass, and you'd probably still kind of see the face, not have it all slumped, but just to try to put a little sand on, you know, like the small veneer of sand. If you get some grass growing there, it's more likely to, you know, hold it and maybe even gather some windblown sand in that beach grass. So it just seems like it would be a better idea to not just leave those rolls completely exposed. But not to bring in so much sand that you're going to have sort of an impact on, you know, that salt marsh that's
6 inches, and just kind of, as I show it here, just going to kind of be a small pile, just so you don't just have wide open sort of coconut rolls across the top. Try maybe that you can get the grass to grow.
So then my other question is, because I think originally it was going to be like a maintain 6 inches. Is this going to be a one time? The grass hopefully establishes, we start catching sand, and then we don't keep doing the 6 inches, because I think the repeat of the 6 inches, there's so much gorgeous spartina out here that I'd be worried that that would get buried.
Right. I would think that it would be to keep it covered, but certainly it could be conditioned that it was a one time, and then we could come back if, you know, we found it didn't stay, you know. I mean, it's really a sort of storm event driven situation as to when those tides occur that would actually get up there and how often that would happen. It's hard to say.
Well, there must be quite a bit of reflective wave energy during the winter, isn't it?
It's not so bad up in here, really. I mean, it's more, you can see how much further out the bulkhead, and then you've got, that's what you're saying, reflective off of each of those.
Sure.
But I think that is somewhat localized as well.
Don't keep those logs covered, even though they're a solid roll, they still start to deteriorate.
Somewhat, but we don't have exactly the same concern that we would in the, what I would call the tube design as opposed to the log, right? If you have the tube and you biodegrade and you lose your outer layer, the system comes apart. It's a log, it's got to go through that whole thing. So I'm not overly concerned with some level of exposure on the logs just because of the mass of them. But I do think that it would be better just for the system, the aesthetics and the sort of just overall interest. If you could have beech grass growing up on top of them, it would be great. But I understand the concern. We certainly don't want to see any adverse effect or impact on that, you know, spartina, which obviously can handle some level of sediment, you know, through there. So I think that, you know, it'll have to be something that is monitored, but that we're just looking to use just enough that you would have something to plant in.
This is something you should have some kind of reporting criteria so you can judge it.
Right.
There's still subject to the monitoring.
There's the monitoring. So
protocol is part of the original order. So those conditions maybe could simply just extend to the 40-foot
whatever those
extension
conditions were, right?
So there's the regular, you know, yearly reporting and storm reporting and all those things that go on, nourishment volumes. Those conditions apply to this. This is just a, we want to put 40 additional feet to get to the wall.
This hasn't been installed yet, so that's
right.
It's been installed.
And you guys were talking about watering. Temporary watering.
Has there been an actual area calculated of the existing salt marsh, or is it just general?
Back to this, application was in 14 when we did the original one. So
yeah, it seems healthier. I'm just wondering if there's a benchmark for if there is.
We haven't because we haven't actually done the work. So
there might be some old photos from the first application.
Certainly the next first monitoring, we're going to pick all that up.
In the original order, it specifically calls for locating the salt marsh in a quantifying area.
Okay.
So that's something that they'll have to be doing on a regular basis.
My other question for that, because I think originally this was planned to be done when the salt marsh was dormant,
mm-hmm.
Are we still going to need to cover the salt marsh with plywood at this point in the growing season? Or is that going to hurt the salt marsh that's starting to grow?
Well, it would only be like the one day, right? So it's only going to be, you're just going to put it down, pick it right back up while you're working. So it's not, you know, something that it's all going to, we don't want to have, and certainly the owner doesn't want to have any damage to the salt marsh. So
I'm just worried if the spartina is growing already that we're going to damage the plant growth.
It doesn't
this point by laying plywood on top of it.
I'm not sure what they have for a schedule to do the work.
Maybe most of this by hand?
Yeah, the logs, certainly. I mean, those logs are, movable by two men, but there still would need to be the need for a mini excavator for sure to put the anchors in and to, clean the area and get it. So there is a level of activity with the mini excavator that, can get right down here easily on the ramp that was down by those kayaks.
Yeah, plus the sand. Even though 6 inches is 6 inches, it's a lot of sand.
A lot of sand. Yeah.
Sand's heavy.
Any questions? Questions from our missing public?
No.
Boredom. That's good. Okay. Hey, Jeff, your recommendation on this one?
Yeah, it is pretty good.
Okay. Make a motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
No.
Nice. Great.
Thank you.
It's pretty much the class question.
Okay. Certificates of compliance. Mill Valley LLC.
Since he's paid all that part.
Mark Rich from Site Design, representing the applicants of Mill Valley Road. We have a request for a certificate of compliance for a house, pool, pool house, the usual landscape and grading, amenities. Everything is outside the 50-foot buffer, as was approved. There's a split rail fence along the 50-foot buffer that was set up to keep everything inside the 50 unaltered. Everything is built outside the 50 as per in substantial compliance with the original approval. No, Jeff has anything to add, having seen it.
Easy. No. Yes, there's number 20. That's the condition about the pool not being drained or discharged to an area of commission jurisdiction.
We have a lot of area outside of wetland buffers, several hundred feet, so we have all down slopes, so we have plenty of place we can discharge it that's not towards the wetland.
Your recommendation on this one?
I recommend that you can have a certificate of points.
Motion to issue the certificate of the one.
Second.
All those in favor?
All right.
Mm-hmm. Any opposed? That's the name.
Thank you.
Five Quays LLC, Five Quays Bachelor Road.
We got a roll, Mark. I've got four in a row.
All right. Excellent. I like that.
Once again, Mark Ritz from Site Design, representing the applicants at Five Quays Pasture. Previously, you issued a certificate of compliance for house and pool work on the property. This is a request. We had a separate notice for the boardwalk. There was a walking path through the wetland going out to the water, and we had come in and requested a boardwalk, elevated fibergrade boardwalk over the wetland sections and to maintain the footpath that was already there. The boardwalk has been installed over the wetlands as per the original approval. Basically all there is to it. There were several wetland sections that were crossed by the boardwalk. Yes, Five Quays. And it was an improvement over the existing path that had boards thrown down on it and all that usual old rubbish going through the wetland sections. Now it's just a cleanly elevated fibergrade boardwalk.
Nice. Jeff, have you seen Quays?
Yep, we were out there today.
Yeah, it
looks great.
Looks good.
Well, there's still some on the next door.
They provide habitat for salamanders and
I see, no play
minor bees.
Cecil LLC, 5153 Hobart Ave.
Drop some boards off. Site design.
This is a project with an in-kind bulkhead replacement on 51 and 53 Hulbert. There was an old timber bulkhead that was in a state of disrepair, and it was, you know, pretty much a drive at another timber bulkhead immediately in front. Nothing, you know, no major significant changes, just an in-kind bulkhead replacement. The work has been completed in compliance with the original approval. I don't know if Jeff has anything to add on this one.
Looks like a shiny new bulkhead.
Lovely.
Same sponsor.
Comments? Jeff's recommendation?
No, I would issue this bill for one.
Three out of
four. 62
Hobart
Ave. LLC 62 Hobart Ave.
And once again, for the final show, Mark Kurtz from Site Design. Representing the applicant to Hobart Ave. This was a project for some building additions and elevating structure in land subject to coastal storm flowage. Full-size plan seems to be AWOL somewhere, so I've got... I've got these here. Basically, structures were elevated. There were some additions put on. There was no substantial grading or altering of grade on the site. All land subject to coastal storm flowage, no other resource areas, no full foundations in this area or anything along those lines. Basically, it was to get the stuff out of the flood zone and put on a few additions and to reconfigure the old secondary dwelling and garage.
Pool was done at the same time, or was that existing?
The pool was done at the same time as well, I believe. So I believe the pool was done at the same time.
Four recommendations. Okay. Jeff, recommendation?
I would recommend that it's constructed in compliance with the pool.
Motion?
And move it there, Jeff.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Have a reissue?
Yes. This is one that we've just had a request in to get a reissue. They just to record the original certificate. No one had the original certificate to record. So it asked us to reissue it. But it was a site that was in compliance. And still in compliance.
Okay.
And to reissue.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Passed unanimously. Orders of conditions. We have three. Little Point Acquisitions, LLC 1113 LLE.
The birds are present.
I think it was one.
Yep. Those are covered. There's a 19, 20, and 21, sorry. Couldn't find my orders.
For everybody?
And your fancy staple machine was in one of my dreams recently. I need to get one.
Teacher dreams.
Yeah, pretty much.
Well, I gotta tell you, my fancy staple machine is my copy machine that came with it. I didn't know it was coming with it until they delivered it and they loaded up the staples. And they said, hey, if you're doing less than like seven sheets, there's a staple with stapler. And I was like, that doesn't make any sense. So.
I'm like, maybe you are. We just don't know how to use it.
That being said, now it's kind of an amazing machine.
Get some mileage out of those.
So, back to the order on 11 and 13.
conditions. There's 19, 20, and 21 that are required from natural heritage. Other than that, it was kind of a repair in place, replace in place project.
Have something on here, nothing shall, no material should be stored at the site. I know that was in the, in the application, or the proposed application.
I mean, we could put a 22, that all materials.
Equipment, materials.
All materials and equipment be stored outside of 25-foot buffer zone, 50-foot buffer zone.
Sounds like they'll be stored in Jetty's parking lot where this is happening. And 20 covers in case piping plovers are still on the beach.
Correct. Right. So it requires them to monitor, and I'm sure if there are plovers, I mean, whether or not the requirement is there, and it's August 31st, state and federal guidelines require a certain level of prohibition if there are birds present. So even if the order doesn't, if the order allows for vehicle restrictions, the guidelines from U.S. Fish and Wildlife wouldn't allow vehicles. So
covered.
They would be covered.
Birds are covered.
In my experience, I've never seen birds. They're past the early part of August.
Yeah.
Even the ones that we nest. I say that now, and this would be the year that they would play.
It would be like a three-time nester problem.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing is, the statistics show that about 90% of nests that are laid after July the 1st, which is really what would get you to this date, fail. Mm-hmm. So they just don't, the chicks don't fail. The chicks fail primarily because they don't have enough time to gain size to migrate, and then they die essentially of exposure. It's a really happy nature, right? So that's good. So that's why they don't.
Okay.
Move to approve as amended.
Okay. We have a second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? That would pass unanimously. Hummock Pond Realty Trust, 86 Hummock Pond Road.
I only drafted this one because it was a project that had been approved before.
I see you anticipated the permanent work.
Yeah, I feel like I asked about that last time.
I'll be honest, when you guys tend to request things over again, like just automatically put them in anticipation of knowing that someone will probably ask. So
should we say, should we amend 23 to say to Mark the 25-foot buffer then, since it's not just the small restoration area? Or is that assumed?
Yeah, so yeah, we make it a little edit in there. So it's a fair mark should be installed to mark the
both the restoration areas.
Well, the restoration area is inside the 25-foot, so mark the 25-foot buffer as no disturbed.
Cormac made that point about the precedence.
Yeah, the
finding.
The greater than 50%.
All right. So, if I can interject on that, and this is kind of an interesting question, and this is something that's always plagued the 25 to 50% rule, is yes, in the area that they're doing work, they are altering greater than 50% of that area. And when you look at the remainder of the lot, of the area of the 25 and 50 from the wetland that goes off of the lot, I'm not 100% sure that they are meeting that in totality. Does that make any kind of sense to anybody?
Yeah.
Let me get the point. Because it's kind of tricky. I actually wanted to talk about
this
for
such a small
2 minutes.
Spot.
Yeah. Is it's a very big lot.
The lot itself is 3.5 acres,
and the delineation that they're showing is that's in there, but the wetland itself has buffer zones, you know, here and, you know, comes around, and then the rest of the lot is here. So I guess what I'm saying, and I should have thought on this during the public hearing, but I didn't until after we closed it, and Cormac made that point, and I was thinking about it. I'm not for certain that they are altering greater than 50% between the 25 and 50. They are in that localized area, but overall, I'm not sure.
Right.
I know that's kind of a tricky question. If you guys wanted to make a finding that simply said this project was previously approved and had expired, and this order is essentially meant to reflect that order, you could. I don't think it's overly necessary. But I
it's just such a great mass amount of habitat on this lot that's not ever going to be affected. It was kind of that 50-foot rule, that 50% rule on this lot.
I mean, I'm not saying it's not worth the discussion.
Yeah.
What I'm just saying is, in the true math for all of it, I'm not sure that it meets it.
Right.
Because if we look localized area by localized area on lot, it changes how we have been interpreting that rule from being a holistic look to an area specific look. And that, if I were someone like Art, that would be a big deal to me because that's a significant change on how you view that 50% and buffer zones and those things over there.
The buffer zones that they presented us, though, and that essentially we approved not knowing what's off, they would have altered greater than.
Maybe. I mean, that's the buffer zones that show too also include road and bike path and those things that are there. I mean, this is the thing that really is hard with this performance. Well, and it's alteration. Mm-hmm. It's already altered inside part of that area for the road and the bike path. I'm just saying it's tricky. And I don't know the answer off the top of my head to a finding or how it is. I'm not even for certain that they require a waiver to that requirement because
let the record show that Jeff Carlson has been stumped.
Here, I'll rephrase it just to make it feel better. I'm not stumped because I'm saying there's a discrepancy in the regulation and in what this project is showing that it's indeterminable at this point whether that performance standard is not in compliance. I'll see a lawyer away. So, but that being said, I think it's a valid point of discussion of whether or not it is, or, you know, I don't want to say, should we be looking at projects where there's just this singular area and viewing that differently? It's tricky.
But we'd be looking at the area between the 25 and 50 relative to a specific like wetland resource area. So even if there was another 25 to 50, would it would it still apply to this wetland?
That's the same resource area. I mean, it's the same wetland with this little indentation. That are they altering the 50% of the area between the 50 and 25 for that resource area? I'm not even sure that the project in totality would hit that because the wetland is so big. And that's what I wish I would have thought of it before because there's no real way to solve it outside of the public hearing. But
yeah, I think it sticks per property per project. Because if you say each little parcel, then you get cumulative impacts all the way around, and everyone can alter theirs between the 25 and 50. You know, and then once you trigger the criteria, then any property owners would have to stop. You know, it's kind of a funny.
Yeah, and if you look at it that way, though, you would, if somebody did a project on top of the road that affected this, then
we've always looked at it on a per property basis.
Right. Yeah.
So if the wetland resource area runs across 10 properties, that it's been 50% per property.
Right.
What I'm saying is, on this property where the property is so big and there's so much wetland,
right?
I don't feel confident that they are
using 50%.
of that area. There may, the other issue is, given the size of the wetland and the proximity to the property lines, I'm not sure that the 25 or 50 is entirely located within the property.
How often does this come up, Jeff? How often do we get a project like this that's surrounding the property itself? So where
this is probably one of three or four times I can think of where it comes up like this. Usually it's much more, usually the lots are so much smaller. I mean, the classic example is Westchester Street, where the wetland kind of runs behind, especially in the 60s, where that wetland runs kind of in the back of all of them.
Mm-hmm.
We've always looked at them as a per-lot basis.
Yeah.
But that wetland is also ginormous. And it's what tricky. This one is the lot is, the wetland is on, primarily on this lot, and the 3.5 acres that are here. And it gets on to the other bigger lots around it too, but
they lot the most. This is the place that
I'm not advocating for one way or another. I'm just saying that it's, this one's a little bit gray. Back and get rid of the lawn, they can
put something there
mm-hmm.
that says, hey, don't cut across here again.
Mm-hmm.
That's there. And then there's a waiver required for this because some of the road gets close to that little ditch that's in there. That was it.
Jeff, this covers like both sections?
Correct. It's the both land bank sections. So the one that's off the little dirt road and the other one.
That was harder to get to.
In the backyard.
All right, move to issue as drafted.
Second.
All those in favor?
Mm-hmm.
Any opposed? Passes. So we have another issue.
Yeah, Vondale, I'll call them out because they signed it out. Vondale Hunter lost in order of conditions before it got recorded. And they signed it out, and none of them can find it in their office. So they've asked us to reissue it. We didn't issue it even that long ago. Press LLC was in February of this year, so
yeah.
Somewhere in the last 3 months
something.
They managed to lose it, which guarantees that as soon as we sign
yeah.
this one tonight,
Murphy's
they
law.
Pick it up tomorrow, it is gone.
It will be found by Friday.
Oh, did they?
So you know.
We'll do it, and if they found it and it works, we'll just shred it. It'll be done.
Okay. All right.
They could have called. They didn't.
You
tell Jane.
We heard nothing.
You can tell Jane and Brian. They need to do a better job.
I love that. I think you know.
It's part of an email chain.
I noticed it. Don't tell Jeff we found it.
So we have a motion. All right.
Second.
All those in favor? Yeah. Passes unanimously with Commissioner Popper.
So now I'm going to mess with them. If they recorded the other one, I'm just going to tell them that they have to record this one since we reissued it. Charge them that extra $75.
Okay. Extension of orders and conditions.
All right, so this
Mass
is
DOT.
This is the Mass DOT project. For anyone who doesn't remember it, this is the in-town bike path. Shockingly, we actually issued that order in 2014, and it expires in a few weeks. They're not done. so really what they're getting at. And they also, new DPW director came in and reviewed the project and reviewed all of the plans and had some pretty significant issues with some of it and some concerns for public safety as it related to getting off the path and onto Orange Street and Washington Street. So they may be coming in with a couple minor mods or amendments. To deal with it, so they've essentially asked for an extension because it was supposed to expire on the 29th. And they are clearly not going to be done with that project in the next 2 weeks. So they've asked for an extension.
Yeah.
The town typically requests the full amount because we're slow, so they've asked for the 3 1-year extensions to go forward. They're hoping it's done before then. The other reason I kind of pointed them towards the 3 1-year extensions because that moves the monitoring requirement that was tied to the permit expiring to cover monitoring for the additional 2 years for the monitoring that we've done. So they originally asked for one, I kind of pushed them to three, so monitoring would stay open and be a requirement for them to finish.
So, that's maybe kind of a stupid question. This is the same parcel that's had, like, so many thousands of pounds of glyphosate dumped.
I don't know where Steve got that from.
But he's referencing this.
Yes.
Yeah.
Have they even started doing the treatment?
No. They haven't.
It seemed a little.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, keep in mind, he did get to spend part of yesterday at the hunter. So, yeah. I'll get to that. So, get a lot of time for himself.
Oh, God.
teaser for the end of the
night. Oh, yeah.
So, all right.
So.
Yes.
Okay, all those in favor?
Yep.
All in favor?
Yep.
I think passes unanimous. Other business, approval of minutes. Anybody have any comments about the minutes? Seeing that, I approve by unanimous consent. Enforcement actions. Oh, he's up, please.
All right.
Can't wait.
Yeah.
Good news. I'll save the best for last. The parcel here, sorry. For anyone that drives down that way, I don't have the pictures with me, unfortunately. The parcel adjacent to 315 Polkas Road, if you drive down there, 315 is the Hollywood Farm parcel. The abutter to that parcel pretty much clear-cut the entire lot, and it looks like they also clear-cut some wetlands in the process and scalped a lot of it. We're still kind of picking through what the totality of it was, but I think at a minimum, some of it clearly required filing to do. So you can go and watch and see the bare soil next to Irises and Softrush right up against Polkas right there.
What's
so
the address?
The physical address, I know it's mixed up in my head, I believe it's 317 Polkas Road.
Oh, the mailboxes are on the other side.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Is this the property that has, like, the guinea hens and birds?
Yes.
Okay. So it's that same parcel.
Or I'm going to say Sherman Street, that's right, so. Don't have it in my head. Excuse me, it is a combination of 315 and 321. Yeah, it's hard to tell because there's work going on in 315. So, just really quickly, I'll use my computer to show it. So as you can see, there's a number of these little like streams that run through the property, and a wetland that's over here, there's wetlands here, there's a wetland in the middle here, and pretty much all of this is gone. So it's just hard to tell where they fall into the buffer zones when there's nothing there. Right?
I mean, they would have
surveyed, so
nailed some gorgeous high bush blueberry in there.
So, but it's gone. So that's the first one.
So this was a recent cutting?
Yeah, looks like probably in the last couple weeks. Oh, like scrape year.
Scrape
year. Oh, really?
Yeah. So it's pretty heavy. So just asking for that to be issued, and we'll bring them in, and I'll try to sort it out a bit more in the meantime, but I think we'll just start the process. Sorry, I'll leave. I was on break today, too, so you only get the back. Okay. See you. Take care.
Okay.
All right, and then the last one that we have, I don't really have any updates on any open ones. I know we talked about it at Field News a little bit, and there have been pictures all over the internet, and we have some today. The property at 93 Baxter Road, so towards the northern end of the geotube area, kind of halfway to the northern, where their bank, it's one of the houses that's left that's right against the bank, right at the top of the bank. Someone installed core logs, like four levels of them, kind of created some pseudo terraces on the coastal bank. To this point, we haven't permitted that activity. This is where it gets tricky. We have an open permit, obviously, for the Wisconsin Beach Preservation Fund for doing bank planting and geotubes within that area. And I don't know if it was just a private owner or that. So we can issue out the enforcement action against the open permit that they're doing work under. we can issue to the property owner where it's all contained, or we can do both and let it sort out how it sorts out. I mean, not for nothing, to be fair, there's been a lot of work going on with sand and replenishment. We found out because it appeared on the internet and no one called to say, hey, there's people doing work. Mm-hmm.
I see this as similar to some of the like land bank properties that other property owners are cutting into, and then it's still the land bank, so that my feeling would be this should go against the project that's currently within that area.
Right, they're part of the project.
Yeah.
They're assigned on as part of the group.
Oh, they're clearly within the group.
Yeah. I mean, right, but they're also part of the group.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah.
And as far as like monitoring the project there, you would say,
yeah.
Hey, what are you doing in my project area?
Yeah.
This seems
so
crazy.
I was going to say, to be fair, I was going to recommend issuing out both. And then that way, get everybody in. Let the finger pointing begin and go from there. But it's clearly an activity that's been done without a permit.
Yeah.
The information we have in the picture we saw was a single guy working by himself and hand schlepping stuff over and doing the work. So it is what it is, but it requires a permit.
Yeah.
And to be also fair, it's also in the vertical section of the bank that we typically have tried to preserve for nesting habitat of bank swallows. So it's typically the area that's there. Bank swallows aren't protected like plovers or terns, but yeah. So be that it may, that's kind of where we are with it, and we'll see it. The good news is we will definitely be seeing Wisconsin Beach in the next 2 weeks because they have their presentation to the board. Maybe they can explain the terms. So we can kind of get a jump on it. So if you want to, someone makes a motion to issue one or both,
we can go from there.
Yeah.
Second. All those in
favor? Right. So there's going to be two, because you're signing them both.
Shut off the internet.
To be fair, my phone will probably ring after Art's phone. So.
Art's already talking.
That's why he's got the surface there with the
iPad. Yeah, it's currently messaging.
Well, I still haven't got to this
one. Give me time. Rush to the car.
I haven't contacted them yet about it because I wanted you guys to actually take action first.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow I can call Mr. Cohen and say,
eh? I mean, he had to see this one coming.
I'm sure as soon as all the pictures got around,
yeah.
Everyone saw
it. I'm sure,
sure there was a little.
People call him immediately, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm.
So.
That's what he wants.
Good times.
Yeah. He's going to get back in the swing of things, you know. Okay. So that's it for enforcement action. Orders, reports, CPC, nothing on AMBDC, mosquitoes?
It's a full moon and it's springtime, so they're going to be out soon. Yeah, they're breeding.
Okay, I don't think we have any other reports, do we?
Oh, I'll do it for CPC. Don't forget next week, anyone that's had an open project with CPC, next week is their little open house of the African Meeting House for Field Head Projects, or if any of you guys want to do it, that's what we do.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's next Tuesday at like 4. Mm-hmm. I don't remember.
I have one commissioner comment.
Sure.
Over there. I know I mentioned it, site visits. Given all of the clearing that's been going on recently, I think we need to try and maybe do an informational ad in the paper or somewhere about clearing and what wetlands look like and that it's illegal, just to put it out there a little bit more, because I just don't even know that some landscape companies would even know that they're doing wrong.
Right.
Some certainly do.
Some do, but I mean, I can say from past experience of my own, it's, you know, there's not a lot known about this.
Right.
And the landscape others, you know, like,
yeah. Exactly.
You know? So, yeah, I think an informational, I don't know how you get it out there.
Mm-hmm. as the Mosquito Control Committee, we wrote a letter to the paper last year, and I know the paper doesn't reach everybody,
right.
But just stating what was going on, just
yeah.
So it's out there.
You know,
I have it for landscapers, but...
The paper you get owners, too, though, so that they know that they need to check, because they're the ones who are ultimately going to get their property listed.
Right. Well, I'd like it to, could it come from the town? You know, because I think people are a little numb, honestly, to, like, the land council.
Right, it would come from
the
town, the conservation commission.
I will say that the commission does have, I mean, we do take in money for professional review of applications and have a little bit to use at the disposal of the board. If we wanted to put together an ad for the newspaper, that's something that would certainly be doable to do. If we want that to be the message or some sort of material for people, then we can certainly put something together. If we want it professionally done, I'm sure we can find someone who would do it.
Put something in like N Magazine, because that thing just sits on the stands for like a month. You know what I mean? Homeowners look at it. I don't know if it's quite the It just seems like it's like, well, paper comes and they laugh at it. Paper comes and goes and it's gone, but it's like at the end it kind of sits there.
Well, maybe we'll get maybe we'll get an ad for the paper and we'll get a magazine to do like a follow-up article on Holly Farm where we can talk about why unpermitted cutting is bad and, you know, what they've had to do and the hoops they've had to jump through. People will be much more into that and they could get those crazy, like, gray tone photos in the background.
With
the commission standing all stern in front of the olive trees. Anyway, we'll figure out something.
Maybe we ought to just start using the issue of fines or thing, too, just so that there's...
That's something we can do. If we had a public hearing for regulations, you can set fines through there to even just say, if you're filing an after-the-fact application, it's an additional... I mean, you can set a fee for what. So if you issue out an enforcement that requires an after-the-fact filing, I mean, not for nothing, that's an indirect way to essentially fine somebody to do it. It's not instantaneous. Circumvents a little bit issuing the actual ticket, but if you said something to the effect of an after-the-fact filing as a result of an enforcement is going to have, instead of the $25 notice of intent fee, is going to be $250 or $300. I mean, you can't get crazy and be like, $10,000, like
$1 million.
But, I mean, it has to be within reason, but that's one way to get to it.
Yeah.
Or you could also have regulations that say something that's as simple as, if you're issued an enforcement action, that automatically gets, and there's a fine limit in the town through the charter, which is where $300 is $100.
It's like small potatoes.
Well, shameless, though. Shameless, because people love shameless. Exactly.
Well, that's the thing is, I have found out here that the money is totally inconsequential.
Yeah.
Whether it's, I hate to say this, whether it's $100 or $100,000, the money for a lot of this is fairly passable. It's the ones that make it to the paper that always get the quickest and the worst response.
Yeah.
I mean, not for nothing, the two biggest ones that have made it to the paper were the Great Wall of Eel Point and the Holly Farm. And how fast those came together, because no one likes to be in the paper. So I have no problem calling the paper and saying, hey, we issued out violations today. Here's your list.
Oh, they love it.
They
love
that sort of news.
Especially if you get a big one. I mean, they're not as concerned, I'll be fair, like the Phil Jan enforcement where they put a manhole in the ground. Small potatoes for them. 36 Pacamo Road where they clear the lot. That raises a little bit more excitement. So, for what it's worth, I mean, those are avenues we can do pretty quickly and easily.
Yeah.
I mean, it requires a public hearing and then a notice after that, so you're looking... If we decided to do that and have a public hearing for just that specific matter, and we had it advertised for next week's paper, we'd probably be looking the first meeting in June to have that public hearing. And if you got it through in one, then... You have to have an effective date to do it and advertise that effective date for those going into place. So, I mean, you really, realistically, late July, early August, before it really took effect, but then you would establish
those kinds of things.
Yeah.
So, and I will tell you, there are a lot of communities that do after the fact filing fees. So if you do it, I mean, there's some places that do your fees double. There's some places that do weird formulas to be like, well, if you cut X amount of vegetated wetland, you figure out that square footage and you multiply that by 75 cents, and then you figure it out from there. And they get really complicated. So we can find something in there to do with, you know, for what it's worth. It's just tricky because a lot of those ones that have those weird formulas are also places like Marlboro who don't have coastal wetlands that they're dealing with. So their primarily violations are vegetated wetland cutting or riverbank cutting or doing something like that. So, but the craziest one I saw was linear feet of riverbank times like 83 cents times 4. And I was just like, who comes up with this? It was crazy.
Somebody works for the IRS.
They had some crazy formula figured out for it. And I was like, and more importantly, who's the poor administrator that's sitting there like measuring on, you know, the side of the river and multiplying by the decimal and then doing it again and being like, your fee is going to be $1,037.22. Thank you very much. This is so weird. Yeah. So, it's crazy. So that's something we could certainly do if people are interested in. We've actually been compiling a list of other communities for what they charge for filing fees, and that makes us feel like a good list.
I think we should.
Yeah, I think we should.
So I will put, you know, is I'll put a draft of what that would look like together for the next meeting. When you guys see it, you guys will put on the agenda for discussion of after the fact filings and violations. After you guys see it, we can set a public hearing date that we can advertise for, and then we can put that in. And we'll just advertise specifically for that, so we're not opening up all of the regulations. We know we have more that we need to adjust, but just to deal with this quickly. And then later, maybe in the winter when it's slow, we can. Overdue. So we're 3 years from the last. Stop talking about it, it's almost
second quarter. Administration, treasurer, staff reports.
No, I'll save my other thing for after.